In 2007, Navy SEAL Lieutenant Jason Redman and his team were battling al-Qaida in Iraq. During a firefight, Jason got shot in his left arm.
I was turned trying to address that arm wound when I took a round from the right side that caught me in the face.
Jason knew he was bleeding out as he felt the life leaving his body.
I called out to God and I said, "Hey, give me strength to go home." And in that moment, I felt like I had strength.
In his book, The Trident, Jason shares how the extraordinary devotion from his wife and kids brought him safely home.
Well, Jason, we welcome you to the program today. As we just saw, you were critically wounded in 2007 when you were leading, really, a mission against a top al-Qaeda leader. Tell us what happened I guess it was day, evening?
No, it was actually very early morning, about 1 a.m. We got the word that the senior leader for the Anbar province of Iraq, a guy that we had been tracking the whole deployment, was going to be in a specific location, something we call a time-sensitive mm-hmm. target. So we launched on that target. He actually wasn't in the building that we were originally taking down. But we got word there was a lot of movement on another house about 150 yards away. I took my team and we moved on that house. And his security element had set up an ambush for anybody that came to that house. And we walked into that ambush. And wow. It was a big gunfight. Myself and several other members of my team were wounded. Thankfully, myself, the most critically, stitched across the body, 2 rounds in the left elbow, and I took a round in the face.
What went through your mind when that initially hit you?
Anger, honestly, at first. I was angry that I had allowed myself and my team to get in this position. We train very hard. Mm-hmm. We try and do things to always have the upper hand against the enemy. And unfortunately, the enemy also gets a vote. War is not a very clear thing. That's why they call it the art of war. Mm-hmm. And the enemy had laid a good trap, and we walked into it. So it was anger at first, and then as the firefight continued on, at last, I was hit right in the very first minutes of the firefight. And mm-hmm. I was pinned down in between my men, who had one point of cover, and two enemy machine guns that had me pinned down about mm-hmm. 15 yards in front of them. And I was continuing to bleed out. I was losing a lot of blood from...
Did you think you were going to die?
I did. Absolutely.
Go ahead.
I actually felt it. I think that anybody who has come that close to death, you can feel it. I think it is a spiritual feeling, and then mm-hmm. there is the physical feeling. And I felt, I started losing the ability to move. I was so weak, I couldn't mm-hmm. even, at one point I remember trying to wiggle the right hand, and I couldn't even move my hand. And there was just a darkness, it was getting hard to think. Mm-hmm. And it was in that moment I came to the realization that this is probably it.
Was it at that moment that you cried out to God?
Yes. So in those final moments, at first I kind of was at peace with it. I just said, this is how I'm going to go out. Mm-hmm. And I didn't like it. I didn't like the thought of here I was, I was going to die in this faraway land in this, you know, dirty mm-hmm. battlefield. But then I thought about my wife and kids, and that made me sad. I thought that I would not see my children grow up. I wouldn't see mm-hmm. my wife again. And it was in that moment that I said, Lord, I want to go home. I need your strength.
You feel like a miracle occurred on the battlefield that day. How so?
I did. Like I said, I went from that moment where I couldn't think, I couldn't move, to when I made that prayer within a couple minutes, I suddenly had strength.
Wow.
I'm not sure how much time passed between that prayer or not, but I had this thought in my mind, you're going to stay awake. So I tried mm-hmm. to stay awake, and finally, my team did an amazing job suppressing the enemy with the help of U.S. Air Force AC-130. And my team leader ran forward through enemy fire to pull me back. They got a tourniquet on me and saved my life.
Wow.
And then... when we finally called the helicopter in, I had gone through this time where I couldn't move. Well, I actually got up and I walked to the helicopter and got on under my own power.
That same stick-to-itiveness, that same grit was evident in a note that you wrote and had posted outside your hospital room as you recovered from this devastating thing. And you basically said, you know, if you're coming in here with any sympathy or pity, don't enter.
That's right. You know, seeing somebody with grievous injuries is hard. I think especially facial injuries. We have a tendency, you know, human beings, we look at faces. And I had some people that came into the room and they were expressing quite a bit of pity. Mm-hmm. And I just said, you know, I'm not going to feel sorry for myself. So I'm not going to allow anybody else to feel sorry for me. So I just said, hey, the wounds that I received, I got in a job that I love, doing it for people that I love, defending the freedom of a country I love. Mm-hmm. You know, this room's going to be a room of optimism, positive energy, intense rapid regrowth. And if you're not prepared for that, go elsewhere.
37 surgeries. It wasn't like you went into the hospital and just healed and came out. What did you learn through all of that? Because God's always about teaching us something in the midst of our pain.
I learned a lot about myself. I learned, probably one of the bigger things I learned, and I talk a lot about this in the book, is sometimes we think leadership is this person standing, you know, on, you know, in front or on top of a horse saying, follow me. And sometimes leadership is the ability to stay the course and stay positive and strong even in your weakest times, and just maintaining that positive mm-hmm. mindset and not allowing yourself or at least outwardly showing people, you know, weakness. Just trying mm-hmm. to say, I can drive forward. Even though you have doubts, even though there is pain, saying, I know that eventually there will be an end to this. You know, the old saying, it's always darkest before the dawn. You know, you keep pressing forward.
Well, you have taken what you went through and created a company that's creating wounded wear now to help guys who are coming out of combat and wounded. And you've written an amazing book called The Trident. Before we go today, I just want you to explain what The Trident is and what you want people to take away from the book.
The trident is the symbol of the Navy SEALs, and it is composed of an eagle, an anchor, a flintlock pistol, and the actual trident. The biggest thing about the trident, and I close the book with this, if you ever look at any military insignia and almost any icon, emblem of the eagle of the United States, the eagle's head is always held high. It's held mm-hmm. high with pride. We are a proud nation, and we should be a proud nation. The trident, the SEAL's emblem, is the only emblem that the eagle has his head bowed. And I never noticed it when I was a younger SEAL. I bought all into the bravado and everything else, and that is an essential component of what makes special operations what it is. But it was at the end of my career when I saw that, and it was actually a senior SEAL leader who pointed it out to me. And I now look at it differently. We've lost so many guys, not just in the SEAL teams, but across the military. So I think the trident is a great symbol of the sacrifice that's been made for this nation that I hope people will realize.
And the respect, do it.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Well, Jason, we thank you for being with us today, and I want you to know you've only heard the tip of the iceberg of Jason's story. Pick up a copy of his book, The Trident. It's available wherever books are sold. You find out more about his wounded wear, go to cbn.com. He's doing some amazing things. Thank you so much. Great to have you here.